White Rabbit presents America Over the Water, written and read by Shirley Collins, with a foreword written and read by David Tibet.
Foreword by David Tibet. I do not know how to introduce a book as important as this is to me, except to state that of those artists whose music I have loved and whose work I have followed with so much joy and excitement over many years, Shirley and her work hold a particularly prominent place in my heart. I remember the moment I first heard her sing, whilst I was in a flat in Clapham, with the sound of traffic and the sight of decay in the streets around me. A friend had told me to buy Love, Death and the Lady by Shirley and Dolly Collins. At hearing that first line in the title track, sung in a voice innocent and despairing, profound and simple, I realised I had come across someone whose art would change my life. As I walked out one morn in May, the birds did sing and the lambs did play. I met an old man by the way. I obtained every album and single by Shirley and her sister that I could find. I realised how little I knew about her life and her work outside of the recordings themselves. There was evidently a rapid and determined progression from the sparse and unadorned singing and arrangements of the first early singles on the Collector label and her first albums on the American Folkways and English Decca labels, Sweet England and False True Lovers, to the splendour of The Power of the True Love Knot, Anthems in Eden, and Love, Death and the Lady, in which medieval, baroque, psychedelic and folk music all rush together to form a structure of heartbreaking beauty. I also found her name on a large number of albums, anthologies of field recordings of American and British music, compiled with Alan Lomax, of whom I then knew nothing. Eventually I met Shirley and Dolly, discovering, to my surprise and sadness, that they had retired as a duo, and that Shirley, then living in Brighton, had given up any idea of ever recording again, although Dolly was still composing music, notably her Humanist Mass with words by the poet Maureen Duffy, as well as The Pity of War, a suit of settings of First World War poems, and a new arrangement of The Beggar's Opera, which she had completed just before her unexpected death in Sussex in 1995. Over many conversations with Shirley, for she was unbecomingly self-effacing about her achievement, and seemingly unaware of how important her work was to so many people, not to mention the exorbitant prices that her records commanded, I found out more about her fascinating story. Her journey into the very essence itself of English song occurred during an amazing life. Born in pre-Second World War Hastings to a family of singers, scholars, activists and characters, she went on journeys to Warsaw and Moscow, travelled to the Appalachians, recorded prisoners at the notorious Parchman Farm, was present at the discovery of the wondrous Mississippi Fred McDowell, and all of this before returning to England, still very young, to create, with her sister Dolly, one of the most powerful and emotional bodies of work of which I know, and collaborating with luminaries such as David Munro, the Incredible String Band, Peter Bellamy, and many other pivotal figures. Shirley told me, many years after we first met, that she was writing the memoirs of her time spent travelling and collecting songs in the States with Alan Lomax. I was delighted to receive the first draft, but on reading it, felt it was only half accurate, missing out so much of what I wanted to read about her own life and experience in North America. She had left out practically all information on herself, and the book read as an account of Alan Lomax's quest, with a retiring young girl from Sussex assisting, who occasionally mentioned herself. It seemed to me to be a great injustice to a woman whose influence and art has so greatly affected so many people, both musicians and listeners, within the folk world and without. Over many rewritings, Shirley thankfully overcame her modesty to write this luminous account of her time in America, interspersed with memories of her family life and how she entered the world of folk music. This book is a touching and important document, an account of the meeting of different cultures in different times, seen through the eyes of a charismatic and courageous woman who, researching these often ignored expressions of the outcast and marginal, asserted the profound humanity of those who gave voice to it. In these pages, we see that the spirit of the deepest and simplest beauty abides in small places. It is also about a woman whose quiet determination and unending interest in people and their stories enabled the whole project, as originally conceived by Alan Lomax, to be carried out. Without Shirley, much of that which is recounted here would have disappeared. The record of African American, Anglo-Celtic, North American, and British song itself would be a ghost of what it is now. She changed absolutely the world of folk music, world music, and even psychedelic music by what she brought into it. And her influence increases. She is our nearest star. Thank you. David Tibet, current 93, London, March 17th, 2004.
Introduction 2022. Over the years, I had almost stopped thinking about the time I lived in America back in 1959. It seemed so far away and so long ago. But that all changed when my mother told me she still had all the letters I'd sent home from the States when I was working with Alan Lomax on the field recording trip that would later become known as the Southern Journey. When I read the letters, memories came flooding back. And with the encouragement of Pip Barnes, my oldest and dearest friend, I started to write. There was so much material, though, that I didn't know how to start the book, convinced that I needed a first line before I could continue. The eventual solution was simplicity itself, as you will see. Then another problem arose. It seems so unlikely that in 1959, such a different time for nowadays, a 24-year-old working-class girl from Sussex should be on a field recording trip in the southern United States, working with America's leading folklorist. I felt I had to explain the backstory to make this credible, how my passion for traditional folk song had ultimately and quite miraculously led to meeting Alan. So I started with my childhood in Hastings. I wrote the first 11 chapters and then the subsequent part of the America story, all painstakingly typed on an Amstrad word processor, and showed it to Pip. His first reaction, a rather bewildered, "You've called a book America Over the Water. I'm halfway through it and you're still in England." There needed to be a solution, and Pip came up with it. Simply alternate the chapters. Little did I know when I wrote the book in 2004 how my life would change. And now 17 years on, here is the new edition of America Over the Water, my take on that unique field trip of 1959. In 1993, just after it was published, Alan had sent me a copy of his book, The Land Where the Blues Began, with a handwritten dedication, with much love and great admiration to one of the sweetest singers and ladies who ever walked and graced the green ways of this earth. Unfortunately, this flattery was quite undone by what seemed an unnecessary, but perhaps merely careless, dismissal by Alan on page 330, when writing about our time in Mississippi. He wrote that I was along for the trip. That really angered me. Along for the trip, I thought. That's not how I remember it. And I had allowed this grievance, this smart, to stay with me for years. And in fact, Alan had said in a later interview with Ken Hunt, Shirley was, of course, the perfect person to take into the field because she loved every minute of it and she took wonderful notes and was a huge help, was great with all the people and a perfect field companion. She helped me in hundreds of ways I didn't even know, being an unobservant, busy male. Now it is my turn to make amends. The final healing came when Dutch filmmaker Roger Kappers made his film Lomax the Song Hunter, released in 2005. Kappers and his crew had retraced Alan's steps from his 1950s field recording trip in Franco, Spain, where people were still living under the heel of the hated Guardia Civil, who were keeping their eyes on Alan's activities. They would appear, he wrote, like so many black buzzards, carrying with them the stink of fear. And although it was some 50 years later, Roger found and filmed some of the people Alan had recorded, though even if they were gone, their families remembered with pride and often tears as they heard Alan's recordings. They joined in with the songs, broke into dances and hunted out the old instruments. Then the film moved towards the end of Alan's life, Alan post-stroke in his swimming pool in Florida. There was a heartbreaking moment of recognition when Roger played some of those Spanish recordings to Alan, and his eyes filled with a light of sheer joy, and I realised afresh, and what I had really known all along, that Alan's inestimable achievements were what really mattered, and how incredibly and uniquely fortunate I had been to share a part of that work and experience with him. When I left America in January 1960, Alan sent me home with precious, complete reel-to-reel copies of all the field recordings of Southern Journey, and I have them still. I trust I've got the ending right for this new edition, one of grace and love, that honours both Alan Lomax's work of some 70 years and the men and women that he recorded in the field, the truth and value of their songs and music, and the debt that is owed to them and to Alan. Chapter 1, The Beginning. They had lain in a drawer at my mother's house for many years, my letters from America. I'd posted them home back in 1959, the year I lived in the States with the American folklorist, Alan Lomax. In the late summer, we made an historic field trip, recording folk music in the deep country of the rural South, and some of these songs would end up being sampled by contemporary American musician Moby and showing up in the Coen brothers' film Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? And on Ry Cooder's soundtrack CD for The Long Riders. It was a journey that started in Virginia and took us into Parchman Farm, the notorious Mississippi State Penitentiary, up Kentucky mountainsides to record Primitive Baptists' open-air prayer meetings, and to the heart of Alabama for a Sacred Harp Convention, into tiny hamlets in the tornado belt of rural Arkansas, where the pioneering spirit still existed, into isolated black communities in northern Mississippi, where we discovered one of the finest hitherto unknown bluesmen, ending our journey on one of the Georgia Sea Islands that had been settled by escaped slaves. Now, people, and certainly those of my working-class background, didn't travel much in the 1950s, and to go to America was virtually unheard of. My letters home form the basis of this book and reflect how things were then. They may well seem naive nowadays, when we can all jet off at the drop of a credit card and to worldwide holiday destinations. So where do you come from, young lady? Well, I'm from England. What? England over the water, said an elderly mountaineer in Kentucky. So how did a girl from Sussex fetch up in America with America's leading folklorist? Chapter 2, London, 1953, Leaving Home. In the late autumn of 1953, I decided to move from Hastings to London, where I could sing and research songs in the library of Cecil Sharp House, home of the English Folk Dance and Song Society, and now known as the Ralph Vaughan Williams Library. In those days, it wasn't the friendly and welcoming place it became under the librarian Malcolm Taylor, OBE, recently honoured, and deservedly so, and you had to take your courage in your hands to brave your way in. The disapproval was almost palpable. I found a job at a bookshop in Belsize Park, rented a bedsitter, lived on a diet of buns and tinned soup, became undernourished, getting painful chilblains on my heels that first winter. I spent what was left of my meagre wages, 29 shillings and sixpence a week, the equivalent, I think, of about £1.50, on books of folk songs and all my spare time at Cecil Sharp House. Thank goodness, Peter Kennedy, son of the director of the English Dance and Song Society and a collector for the BBC, was trying to make the house more welcoming and accessible to young people, and he and John Hasted, a physics professor at University College, encouraged us by giving us an informal space where we could sing. More importantly, they brought up to London old traditional singers for us to listen to and learn from. The great ones were still alive. Harry Cox from Norfolk, Bob Roberts from Suffolk, and George Maynard from Sussex, whom I especially loved. He reminded me so much of Grandad, who had died while I was away at college. And he sang wonderful songs such as Polly on the Shore and Our Captain Calls All Hands, songs which struck me to the heart. I still think him the greatest English singer. I heard Seamus Ennis, the magical Irish Julian pipe player, and the remarkable travellers Margaret Barry, Phoebe Smith and Davy Stewart. I soaked up the singing and the styles. The folk scene was gradually opening up in London, and the most famous of the clubs was the Troubadour in Earl's Court, a coffee bar owned by two charismatic Canadians, Mike and Sheila Van Bloemen. At one point, they gave me a job waitressing in the coffee bar, where taciturn Richard Harris was a daily customer, making a coffee and a newspaper last all morning. Singers came from far and wide to sing there. Alex Campbell was always welcome, as was the young Martin Carthy. Our favourite Americans were Daryl Adams and Rambling Jack Elliott, complete with cowboy hats and boots and a laconic Western style of singing, a bit reminiscent of Woody Guthrie. So when a young interloper turned up and sang pretty much like them both, I didn't reckon much of him and didn't think much of his chances as a singer. His name was Bob Dylan. I better confess at this point that I also had the same opinion of Paul Simon, who appeared bottom of the bill at the De La Warr Pavilion in Bexhill, if my memory serves me right. Appearing above him were the Waterson Quartet on their nationwide tour, I think they'd just come down from Hull, and Shirley Collins, England's versatile young instrumentalist. I could play six chords on the banjo, and yes, I did revise my opinion of them both. My circle of acquaintances gradually widened. I met Ewan McColl, a leading figure of the folk revival, and was invited to go to Warsaw to sing at a World Youth Peace Festival. I was familiar with the sights of bomb damage at home, but I was shocked by how the walls of buildings in Warsaw were pockmarked with hundreds of bullet holes, and by how utterly desolate and unnervingly silent was the concentration camp we were taken to visit. Then a couple of years later, I was off to Moscow. It was a memorable journey, and when we changed trains at the Polish border and climbed up into the big Russian train, I was thrilled to see a huge red star on the front of the engine. At that time, Stalin was still Uncle Joe to me, the name we'd known him by as an ally throughout the Second World War. On our journey across Russia, the train stopped occasionally at little halts where groups of people offered black tea sweetened with a spoonful of jam. I was very touched by these encounters. It didn't occur to me then that they might have been orchestrated, and I quickly learned to say hello and thank you and peace and friendship in Russian. Our wooden slatted seats were hard, but the thrill of the journey outweighed the discomfort. What I found difficult, though, was chewing my way through leather-tough garlic sausage, my first experience of such food, and trying to eat a bowl of clear soup with a whole hard-boiled egg rolling about in it, using only a spoon as the train lurched along. I was in Moscow to sing, and I was taking part in a concert in the Kremlin, and I should have remarkable memories of this, but all I can now recall is sitting waiting for my turn to sing and having a premonition that the girl I was sharing a hotel room with was stealing my money, which I had foolishly left behind, and sure enough, when I got back, it was gone. Luckily, I had two nylon slips with me, which I sold on the black market and was solvent again. I was in a production of a ballad opera that Ewan had written for Joan Littlewood's theatre workshop. replacing the singer and actress Isla Cameron, who was ill. But I was inexperienced, and my lack of interest in acting inevitably made the association short-lived. On my return to London from Moscow, I accepted an invitation from Ewan McColl to a party he was throwing for Alan Lomax, who was coming back to England after 2 years collecting folk songs in Spain and Italy. I already knew of Alan through his series of folk music radio programmes for the BBC, Adventures of a Ballad Hunter, produced by a young David Attenborough. He played field recordings made by him and his father John in America for the Library of Congress, and I remember how thrilled I was by both the music and Alan's accent. So the invitation threw me into a panic at the prospect of meeting my hero. What would I wear? I had so few clothes, so little money. I decided to make myself a skirt. I had one pattern I knew I could follow, a tiered affair, three lengths of fabric, short tier at the waist, gathered into a longer one, then a still longer one to give fullness at the hem. The material I chose for my skirt was navy needle cord, a reasonably fine one, but I must have looked a bit of a bundle in it. However, at the party, there Alan Lomax was, an affable, tall, solid Texan with a big head of shaggy dark hair, and he put me in mind of an American bison. I blurted out that one of my ambitions was to go to the Library of Congress to hear his field recordings, and he said he was amazed I even knew about them. He had great warmth and an irresistible chuckle. I fell in love, and he seemed to like me too, in spite of my skirt. I didn't marry him, but after a short courtship, I went to live with him in Highgate. During this time, Alan was completing his Columbia World Folk Music series and his book for Castle, The Folk Songs of North America. I was his editorial assistant and his lover, although I was very nervous of the fact. Things were different then. I was embarrassed and afraid of what people would think. I'd much rather have been married, as living together was unheard of, at least in the circles I'd been used to moving in. They were busy and eventful times, the house often full of visiting American bluesmen, Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee, Memphis Slim and Muddy Waters, for whom Alan cooked a special southern dinner of fried chicken and smothered greens to make him feel at home. It tasted wonderful, but looking back, I wonder if it wasn't a little patronising of Alan. Still, it could have been worse. He could have cooked chitterlings and corn pone. Another friend of Alan's, an American living in Hampstead, was the screenwriter Donald Ogden Stewart, and it was many years later I learned that he wrote the screenplay for one of my favourite films, The Philadelphia Story. Life wasn't without its difficulties, though. We were sharing the flat with Alan's 10-year-old daughter, Anne, his ex-wife Elizabeth and her partner Herb, who were writing a book about Spain, and inevitably there were problems. I don't think I coped too well. I was too young and unworldly. Alan was 20 years older than me, and I was only 10 years older than his daughter. It must have been hard for Anne to have both her parents under the same roof, but living with other partners. I was nervous of Elizabeth. I felt she resented me being there, and she was a fiery, proud Texan. I was hopelessly inexperienced in things domestic. Elizabeth was a wonderful cook. Her Texan and Spanish dishes were a revelation to me. The good food revolution was still many years away, and all I knew how to cook was liver and onions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.